I'd like to express appreciation to everyone for being here on time. Every time we have a conference, and if it's indicated the conference is going to be an all-day conference, you can be certain that there are a lot of people who are going to get in the middle of the day and won't be here on time. But we're going to be pushing a very tight agenda, which is why we're going to have to really be disciplined with this process. My name is Omali Yeshitela, and I am the chair of the Black is Back Coalition for Social Justice, Peace, and Reparations. I'd like to express my appreciation to everyone who has come out to participate in what we think is going to be an extremely important conference, a national conference, on the 2016 elections and the struggle for Black self-determination. In the coalition, we thought it was critical that we have this discussion and try and engage as large and diverse a sector of the African population as possible. What has become clear to us for some time, in fact, the basis of our coming together in the beginning 7 years ago, is that the social system that we live and suffer under is experiencing severe crisis. Crisis abounds. Every time one goes to the internet or turns on the news or opens a newspaper, that's what we see, crisis. In one way, the crisis has been reflecting itself for a while, as well as in the electoral process. We saw that when a handful of us met together on September 12, 2009, in Washington, D.C., concerned about the selection of this man, Barack Hussein Obama, as the Democratic nominee and then election as President of the United States. We felt like Obama's selection was something that was both a manifestation of severe crisis of the social system and also an attempt to solve this crisis of the social system by giving imperialism the face of the slave. And many people would not join us initially when we called for this meeting, but we had noticed across the country there were a handful of people who were really struggling to make sense and to provide our people some leadership around this question of the election and Obama. And they included people like Glenn Ford here from Black Agenda Report, who almost single-handedly, almost, was debating everybody who he could lure into the arena to have a rational discussion based on principle and based on evidence of the significance of the selection of Barack Hussein Obama, what promises that held for our people engaged in struggle and the overall struggle against imperialism. And then there was Nellie Bailey from Harlem, who is a longtime activist, sometimes identified with the housing issue, but otherwise just involved in the struggle against imperialism, and a few other people. And it was really good. Jared Ball was one of those persons. And we were able to come together and have this meeting. And we said, look, let's pull together a coalition, and this is September 12th, and we should organize a march on the White House. I think that was scheduled for November 7th. So in a matter of 6 weeks or so, we said, let's have a national mobilization to march against the White House. And we said, let's call this coalition the Black is Back Coalition for Social Justice, Peace, and Reparations. And we thought it extremely important to do that because Obama was being presented as evidence of a post-racial America, that the crisis that confront our people all the time has been resolved by the selection of this man as the President of the United States. And so we made a declaration, black is black. And this was in the face of having some of us experience either directly or indirectly the black revolution of the 60s, when there was an actual revolutionary movement that existed in this country and that American government had crushed militarily through assassinations, mass jailings, and terror that was waged throughout this country. So we said, black is back. And we said, let's pull together this coalition and let's organize this coalition around these principles of unity. We said, henceforth, we will define the character of the coalition as anti-imperialist, anti-imperialist. And we thought that was important for a number of reasons, because sometimes people who say they represent us like to pretend that we exist outside of history and the rest of the world, that there's some solution to the black question that can be accomplished without recognition of our relationship to the overall struggle that the rest of humanity is engaged in and primarily engaged in as a consequence of activities of the United States government. So we said that it is anti-imperialist. And we also said it was anti-imperialist because we were also concerned that it was a time when, leading into the U.S. aggressions, most recent aggressions in the Middle East, with Iraq and Afghanistan and what have you, there was a situation, they took polls, and more than 70% of Africans in this country were opposed to the war being waged against Iraq and Afghanistan. More than 70% of white people were for the war. Yet, the anti-war movement was lily white, with the common refrain of, where are the black guys? Well, the black guys were involved in a war that had been undeclared. And it was happening throughout the streets of this country and through the black world, all around the black world, but the anti-imperialist movement or the anti-war or peace movement was unable to address that war. And so we say we are anti-imperialist because imperialism articulates itself. It's not just an abstract concept, but it articulates itself in the real world with real consequences that might be drones in North Africa and Pakistan and places like that. And it might be officer friendly in Houston, Texas. That's how imperialism works. And so we said that we have to move this discussion and challenge this narrative right now, even as it's dominated by what might be characterized as an anti-war or peace movement. That's why Africans could not be found in these anti-war demonstrations, though the majority of our people were opposed to the war as compared to white people, because we were engaged in war by ourselves, in isolation, and in fact, the white left would have to go make sure that they didn't get off the interstate in the wrong place going to their anti-war demonstrations, or they might be met by police war against African people in our communities. That was unacceptable. So we said, we have to say that it's not even good enough to say, just call for peace, that it is absolutely necessary for us to align ourselves with the oppressed peoples of the world. Peace is not good enough. So we say not just peace, but victory to the people of Afghanistan against U.S. occupation and imperialism. Victory to the people of Palestine. Victory to the oppressed peoples around the world, and victory to the struggles of African people right here in this country. And we say that any legitimate anti-war or peace movement, as it's characterized, must include that understanding for it to claim legitimacy. We say we have to say something about the concentration camp in this country, euphemistically referred to as Indian reservations, where nobody even speak of them if they're not in the room, but who have a lifespan in the 40s on their own land. We have to say something about the fact that a war was made against Mexico that stole half of the territory and then delegitimize the people from whom it was stolen. Now they're illegal aliens and what have you. What about a peace movement? What about an anti-war movement when it comes to these people? Do we understand then that war is only when the imperialists acknowledge what they are doing in some place in the world? Is that the only war? Is war the only thing that challenges, makes it possible or likely that white kids are going to have to go to foreign lands and die? We said war has to mean more than that. And so we said a principle of unity has to be anti-imperialist. And we will redefine the significance and the meaning of imperialism so that it fits the requirements of Africans and other oppressed people. We say that, furthermore, we unite with the principles to fight against imperialism in all of its manifestations, such as colonialism, balloon bursting, neo-colonialism, Zionism, military occupation, proxy wars, and economic embargoes and trade restrictions. Equally as important, we recognize and agree that there is an undeclared war devastating African people in the United States. This was 2007. And I think it's important to say that because 7 years later, of course, we would see August 9th in Ferguson, Missouri, where the masses of our people rose up. I say our people. These were not college professors. These were not the know-it-all in the so-called movement. These were ordinary black, young black working class people who took on the U.S. imperialist state in full view of the rest of the world and fought them to a standstill in the streets of Ferguson, and a struggle that's still going on even as we have this discussion. We agree, this is the principle of unity, with the principle of equal democratic representation and voting rights of the organizations within the Black is Back Coalition. We agree to respect the ideological differences between the organizations of the coalition. We agree to resolve our disagreements through a democratic voting process. We stand in solidarity with the anti-imperialist resistance occurring all over the world. We agree that African people worldwide must have self-determination, and that the oppressed peoples of the world must have self-determination as well. We agree that African people worldwide are due reparations from the colonialist, imperialist powers of the world. These are the principles of unity of this coalition. And that was what we declared on September 12th. Well, on September 12th, we declared creation of the coalition. It would be January of the following year where these principles were agreed upon. So those are the principles of unity of the coalition. The coalition does not attempt to be a substitute for any particular organization. It is an organization of organizations and institutions. Black Agenda Report is one of the institutions. The Institute of the Wilson out of Chicago? Say it again. No. Please. That's all right. Brother Cam Howard, the brother out of Chicago with the, in Cobra was part of it. From the very beginning, Sister Dorothy Lewis. Amos T. Wilson Institute is a part of it. And Cobra is a member organization of the coalition. And there are various other entities who the Cory Bell Foundation, Cory Ball Foundation, out of St. Louis is a part of it and constitute a part of the steering committee. The People's Organization of Progress out of Newark is a part of the coalition, and there are others. But each of us have our own organizations. We have agreed upon these principles of unity. We haven't tried to define how these principles of unity will be articulated by any particular organization, but these are the basic principles that we can unite around that will allow us to have a common trajectory, and that's what's been critical for us. Because what has been absent for the longest period of time, subsequent to the defeat of our revolution, is a movement that has no focus at all. It has just been out there and ready to be taken up and ripped off by any charlatan that comes around. And there are charlatans who have done it from what's the charlatan's name? Say it again. Al Charlatan? Jesse Jackal, you know. I mean, you just name them. There have been all kinds of charlatans who have been sucking on the people because their focus have been destroyed by a military assault on our movement that killed Malcolm, killed King, destroyed the Black Panther Party, assassinated the co-founder of our party, and crushed many other militant organizations throughout this country, most of whom we had never heard of. We don't even know how many people were arrested and chased out of the country during that struggle in the 1960s, and we're still trying to recover from that even as we have this discussion. So this is our coalition. Everybody said you couldn't do this coalition. Some people refused to participate in this coalition. Some people we've known since the 1960s who call themselves black nationalists and black communists and Marxists and all of this refused to participate. And they refused to participate because they were going to be with the Democratic Party, except they didn't say we're with the Democratic Party. They say we're with his mouthpiece, his black face, Barack Hussein Obama. And somebody needs to tell them that the Democratic Party of Obama is the Democratic Party of George Wallace. It is the Democratic Party of imperialism. It has never been a revolutionary organization, never has been, never will be. It's the Democratic Party. And to have united with Obama against an expression of black resistance is to unite with the Democratic Party in imperialism, notwithstanding their intentions. So many people refuse to work with us, but history has proved us out. And many of the others who initially refused have been trying to come up with an eraser that can somehow magically eradicate where their unity was a few years ago. They didn't actually mean that they were with Obama. They just kind of sort of meant they were with Obama, something to that effect. So I want to express appreciation to everybody for coming out to participate in this discussion, because the crisis of imperialism still abounds. And we see evidence of it again this year, this electoral season, in the electoral process. That's what it means when 17 people from the Republican Party was running for the nomination. That's what it meant when five or more persons from the Democratic Party were running for the nomination. It meant a crisis of imperialism. It meant that the struggles of the peoples around the world had so successfully deprived the imperialist of his lifeblood, his parasitic lifeblood, that it was almost every rich white man for himself. And every rich white man and a couple of rich white women for themselves. And so that's what we saw, this whole imperialist ruling class that were fractured and disunited. And the only thing that's united them up to now is Donald Trump. And that's another story. So I'm going to go ahead and open this up. I would be functioning shorter as a co-MC with comrade sister Sadia Saraj here. And she'll keep me in line. And we're going to really struggle around the time question because we don't have much time. We have an incredible agenda with incredible presenters who will be coming forward, and we're going to have to fight for every bit of the time that we have. This is one of, and I want to thank the St. Mary's Episcopal Church for allowing this conference to happen here. The electoral process is one that has been perfected over a number of centuries. It established the process within capitalist democracies that provides for generally nonviolent struggles between contending sectors of the white ruling class for control of the capitalist colonialist state. This is something that our coalition talked about and agreed with as recently as 4 years ago in 2012, where we had a conference in Newark, New Jersey. But I have to say that we are an organization of organizations. And some of what I will say in this presentation has been agreed upon. We've agreed upon it in the coalition, but some we have not agreed upon. And they will come from me, because I am an organization I also chair, is the African People's Socialist Party. And some of the views will represent the views of the African People's Socialist Party. I shall try to be clear when I am representing the views of the African People's Socialist Party, but I have to say that because nobody speaks, everybody does speak from the perspective of the institutions and organizations that they represent. So I don't want to be disingenuous to say that this is the view of the coalition. It's not. We put out, I thought, a very important document in 2012, August 2012. We had a national conference in Newark, New Jersey, on the election, Barack Hussein Obama and the struggle for black power, and where we laid out and voted on, I think, a very clear position on the electoral process. And included in that conference was Glenn Ford and Lawrence Ham and Diop Olubala and I think, I don't remember the names of everyone else, but it was a very good panel of people involved in that discussion. But this will be a bit different. It also allows the white ruling class, that is to say the electoral process, to carefully vet all who would represent U.S. white power. The system provides political positions and protocols around almost every question, as well as the corporate advisors that shape and guide the activities of presidential candidates before and after their election to office. Donald Trump has presented the white ruling class with a problem during this presidential election season. Initially treated as comic relief by the ruling class media, the white billionaire now has the ruling class frantically up in arms in an attempt to destroy his candidacy and guarantee he does not achieve the nomination of the Republican Party. This is because Trump has not been vetted. He does not rely on position papers from the legion of Machiavellian political parasites in the service of other sectors of the bourgeoisie. While Trump's position on most issues are not different than those of the so-called establishment politicians of either party, they are generally unvarnished. Other politicians carry out white nationalist policies, but unlike Trump, they do not say this is what they are doing. For example, although the white candidates of both parties condemn Trump for talking about building a wall to keep Mexicans out of the land stolen from Mexico at gunpoint in the 1840s, none of them talks about the U.S.-created fence already existing for that purpose. Nor do they mention the fact that U.S. President Barack Hussein Obama has actually deported more Mexicans than any president in modern history. And none of them talks about why he or she would find the wall preventing Mexican entry into the U.S. as offensive, while supporting the white nationalist settler regime of Israel that is constantly erecting walls to prevent the movement of Palestinian Arabs on their own stolen land. This is just an example of the hypocrisy of the white rulers when it comes to the condemnation of Trump. His problem is that the sophisticated political handlers of the other candidates know how to practice the American tradition of saying one thing and doing another, of being for freedom of speech while condoning police beatings of Africans for daring to question a lowly street cop. By the way, Trump is getting handlers. Nevertheless, in the country where Muslims are routinely arrested and held in secret detention camps and tried without the benefit of seeing evidence, where even today Muslims are being held in a U.S. concentration camp on occupied Cuban land, Trump is characterized as racist for exposing the deep-seated white nationalist sentiments among millions and perhaps the majority of white people. However alarmed white rulers are of Trump's current success, high-profile black militants are frantic. They have joined the chorus of white electoral political activists claiming that Trump represents the rise of fascism in the U.S. Actually, Africans have led the charge with this characterization of Trump as fascist. While U.S. Senator John McCain was the fascist threat in 2008, during his campaign for president against Drone Meister Barack Obama, today Donald Trump is the fascist reason for sticking with the Democratic Party candidate. This is a pitiful display of the sense of powerlessness experienced by Africans who would lead our movement during this time of imperialist crisis. It is a display of supreme political punkishness that stems from the defeat of the revolutionary black movement of the 1960s and is captured by opportunists who have no vision of liberation through the conquest of independent black political power over our own lives, a situation from which we have not yet fully recovered. The Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee demand for black power, Malcolm X's declaration of the ballot or the bullet, and the Black Panther Party agreement with Chinese revolutionary Mao Zedong that political power comes from the barrel of the gun have all succumbed to sheepish bleatings of Black Lives Matter, feel the burn, and ready for Hillary. It was not Trump and the fascists who killed Malcolm, King, Panthers, Lumumba, and others. It was not Trump and the fascists that chased black militants underground and out of the U.S., that defeated the black revolution of the 60s. This was done by ordinary non-fascist, sometimes liberal representatives of both ruling class parties and supported by the general white population. Republican and Democratic Party presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy of the U.S. joined with anti-fascist governments of Belgium and France in arranging the brutal assassination of Patrice Lumumba of what was once known as the Belgian Congo. Even before white people discovered fascism, Belgium and the white world were sucking the blood and resources of Africa and the world and reveling in their so-called democratic tradition. They were democratic colonialists. It is an absolute historical distortion for Africans to use the concept of fascism as the basis of our response to political phenomena. At the very time white communists and other leftists were demanding a united front against the fascist demons of Germany, Italy, and Spain, the whole white world was luxuriating in the benefits of non-fascist democratic colonialism in Africa and throughout the world. Indeed, the Second Imperialist World War, usually referred to as World War II, was a war to redivide the world, including the colonized Africans and others among white powers, fascists and anti-fascists alike. It was a time that non-fascist democratic white lynchings of Africans was the national pastime in the U.S. Non-fascist democratic lynchings of Africans was the pastime in this country. It was a time when the U.S. president from the Democratic Party, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, supported and beloved by the whole white left, including the U.S. Communist Party, was throwing Japanese with American citizenship into concentration camps here in the United States. Whatever the myriad of clever, scientific-sounding definitions used to explain fascism, what is clear is that fascism is something that affects white people. Fascism is when white governments treat white people in an undemocratic manner, most consistent with the way white governments treat Africans and the colonial peoples of the world all the time. Therefore, the solution for us is not a fight against fascism, which is a fight for a kinder gentler white power desirable to white people, but a fight for our own independent revolutionary black power. Genuine black revolution would black leadership would understand this. Genuine black leadership would understand this, and genuine African leadership is similarly unimpressed with Democratic Party presidential contender Bernie Sanders as a solution for our advancement. Sanders has succeeded in winning the support from several high-profile black activists, some of whom are legitimate militant opponents of various political expressions of our oppression. Many see Sanders as a refreshing alternative to the presumptive Democratic presidential nominee Hillary Clinton, whose political reputation has been sullied beyond repair, most recently as a partner in crime with her husband, who put 100,000 policemen on the street of the U.S. to occupy, colonize African communities and appease the bloodthirsty requirements of white people for popular support. One of those cops might have killed Mike Brown, might have choked Eric Garner to death, certainly committed all the kind of heinous crimes against our people throughout this country. Hillary, who working with the Obama regime, presided over the attack on Libya and the execution, I should say lynching, of Muammar Gaddafi, has further exposed herself as a shameless political hustler at the beck and call of bankers and financiers who control both political parties from smoke-filled rooms out of sight of the general public. And I might be wrong in saying smoke-filled rooms, because most of the ruling class have become quite health conscious. And many have stopped smoking cigarettes. Nor can the history of the Clintons' looting of mineral resources throughout Africa, especially Congo, be covered over forever. We continue to be nauseated by the Clintons' Foundation's looting of the $10 billion donated by people from all over the world for the people of Haiti following the 2010 earthquake. The majority of those resources have never gone to Africans in Haiti, as thousands still live in desperate conditions. While it is perfectly all right for the obvious political leeches, preachers and the like, and the general mass of politically uninformed Africans to support Clinton, the sophisticated militant progressives and leftist black notables could not openly support the Democratic Party during the primary season through an affiliation with Hillary Clinton without exposing their own opportunism. Hence, feel the burn. Bernie Sanders is acceptable to progressive black leaders because he is a non-revolutionary opportunist who uses words like socialism and revolution as attractors for other non-revolutionary opportunists. He is acceptable because he does not threaten the system of capitalism resting on the colonial oppression and bone-deep exploitation of our people. Sanders nearly promises a paltry $15 per hour minimum wage bribe to the workers who create all the value and all the profit for the capitalist system on stolen land using stolen labor and resources. Sanders also calls for free university education and universal health care like that which exists in certain European countries. And although he does not specifically speak to any of the critical issues confronting African people, his is a riding tide lifts all boats kind of political inference that has proved successful in winning the support of black opportunists in the past. Whatever Sanders has with the African community, whatever success Sanders has with the African community will reflect the weakness of the U.S. front of the African liberation movement. In the first place, only those who attach no revolutionary significance to the term can consider Sanders an affirmed Zionist, a socialist. As quietly as is kept nowadays, a socialist is not someone who simply makes a declaration. It's not a feeling. It's not a beneficent capitalism that takes good care of the workers. Socialism is the early stage of communism, a point in which the workers, under the leadership of their own independent revolutionary party guided by advanced revolutionary theory, have destroyed the state power of the white ruling class and themselves become the state on the road to the development of a classless society without exploitation and oppression. Socialism is that point where an economy based on private ownership of the means of production has been transformed to socialized ownership of the means of production. This is a big difference from giving the workers $15 an hour of all the value that they have created. While Sanders has complained about the control of the electoral process by what he calls the billionaire class, he has not condemned imperialism itself. At best, Sanders is calling for an improved, more perfect imperialism. There is much ado being given to what is called the enthusiasm gap between the Democratic and Republican Party supporters during this primary election season, with the Democratic Party being described as suffering an enthusiasm deficit within its base. Actually, that is incorrect. The enthusiasm gap is only real if one subscribes to the definition of the ruling class pundits and media who base this gap on the lack of turnout for the Democratic Party's presumptive winner when compared to the dynamism injected into the Republican Party by the participation of Donald Trump. The fact is, there is tremendous enthusiasm for the candidacies of Sanders and Trump, who have been considered the outliers of their parties until Trump became a serious contender for the Republican nomination. In reality, there is an enthusiasm gap between the overlapping masses of white people united with Trump and Sanders, and those united with the establishment leaders of both parties. That's where the enthusiasm gap is. This reveals a serious political contradiction that is ripe for exploitation by a genuine revolutionary movement. It is white people following lily-white political agendas who are in motion. It is white people following lily-white political agendas who are in motion. This is a problem because most Africans are trapped in the white nationalist bourgeois-controlled Democratic Party, either as supporters of Clinton or Sanders. What we are really viewing here is an African leadership deficit that is complicated by a deep-seated opportunism within the African community that has gelled since the defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s that killed King and Malcolm, destroyed the Black Panther Party and other revolutionary organizations, and jailed and dispersed the cadre upon whose backs our revolution was fought. The African People's Socialist Party and the Uhuru movement not only survived the imperialist onslaught against our struggle for national liberation, for our freedom from the U.S. colonial domination of our people, but we have continued to struggle and build throughout the years of defeat and terror, because that's what we've experienced. Because Africans are being motivated in elections by fear. Scared of Trump, so let's go to this white guy. Or go to this feeble Negro. Scared of Trump, so that's what we do, you know. Our objective is to win our total liberation. We are determined that no one else should ever rule African people again, either directly or indirectly through neocolonial stooges. Every day our work is in preparation to win our revolutionary liberation and to govern ourselves. We are serious. We are serious about the contest for black power. For us, it is the only logical basis for all the work we do. Every demonstration, every election campaign, every institution we build is for the purpose of taking and wielding black political power over our own black lives. But more than this, we recognize that the socialism that Sanders talks about is impossible within the framework of the existing system and the framework of his own imagination. For example, Sanders, like most other candidates and like Obama himself, has stated emphatically his opposition to U.S. and white reparations to African people colonized within the United States. He is not very different from most white people in this regard, or from white socialists for that matter. But for a socialist, opposition to reparations would be difficult to justify in an era of independent revolutionary black leadership. This is because the fundamental struggle within the capitalist system is that struggle by workers to take back the value of labor stolen by the white rulers that is generally recognized as surplus or profit. So Sanders is either talking about white socialism, often called national socialism, usually associated with fascism, right? Or he is not a genuine socialist, or both. There can be no struggle on earth by workers for a return of stolen value from labor that is more critical than the struggle of African people whose colonization and enslavement extorted the greatest expropriation of forced labor in human history. Yeah. Of course, Sanders cannot genuinely agree with the reparations demand, because this is a demand that gets to the crux of the matter. The fact is that it is the stolen labor and resources of Africa's and the world's colonized peoples that constitute the pedestal upon which the entire white capitalist social system rests today. It is what Karl Marx called primitive accumulation, but which is better defined as parasitism, that builds and sustains the white-centered world economy and white people up to now. It is better defined as parasitic capitalism. Indeed, the crisis of imperialism that Trump and Sanders supporters are responding to today is a consequence of the world's oppressed fighting to take back our own resources for our own future. It might even be called armed reparations. This is true from Afghanistan to Harlem. It is true throughout the entire African world on nearly every continent. Now, for the first time in history, the world is ripe for the revolution that can usher in real socialism, not just an opportunity for socialists to take power, as has occurred in every instance in the past. This is why we say that the road to socialism is painted black. This is why the African liberation movement must forge our own independent agenda for our freedom. This is why we must develop a selfish agenda that speaks to the needs of our people, regardless of whether white political parties and white people can unite with us or not. The fundamental contradiction we are confronted with is not the unwillingness of white political institutions and/or people to unite with our agenda. The fundamental contradiction for black people in the entire world, colonial subjects who too often tremble at the thought of upsetting white people and white systems, is the absence of our own independent agenda and the revolutionary leadership willing to lead our people in its pursuit. The views being expressed in this representation do not represent an agreed upon position of the Black is Back Coalition for Social Justice, Peace, and Reparations. They are the views of the African People's Socialist Party, a coalition organization that I chair. As an organization of organizations, it is common that the views of the different organizations, institutions of the coalition are reflected in the various presentations offered up in its meetings and conferences such as this. Sometimes the views become the views of the coalition by acclamation, sometimes not. However, the views in this presentation are consistent with the position taken by our coalition during our annual conference held in Newark, New Jersey in 2014. And they are consistent with the anti-imperialist principles of self-determination of our governing documents. Nothing in this presentation, however, should be interpreted as total opposition to our participation in the electoral process. In fact, what should be understood by this presentation is opposition to viewing the electoral process as the only or primary vehicle for struggle. As the only or the primary vehicle for struggle. For those who value electoral politics, it is worth noting that it was not electoral politics that won Africans the right to vote in the United States. It was the independent struggle by African people across the ideological spectrum that won that concession from a brutal white power that brutalized and murdered Africans as part of the resistance to this simple democratic right to vote in a system rigged against our success. Several of the members, organizations of the coalition have participated in electoral politics, including this writer, myself, and our party. And the coalition endorsed and the successful candidacy of a former leader of the Provisional Government of the Republic of New Africa, Chokwe Lumumba, for mayor of Jackson, Mississippi. Our coalition also endorsed the candidacy of Ron Gochez of the Mexican National Liberation Organization, Union de Barrio, for a position on the City Council in Los Angeles, California, at that 2014 National Coalition Conference in Newark. The Black is Back Coalition intends to move our general struggle forward by initiating an independent national Black agenda for self-determination. This is where we're going. We have to move forward toward the initiation of an independent national Black agenda for self-determination. This is something that our steering committee has already voted on. We haven't voted on exactly how this thing should look, but that's what we've said. The Black is Back Coalition for Social Justice, Peace, and Reparation will use this conference today on the 2016 election, the struggle for self-determination, as part of a process culminating with our traditional November rally, march on the White House, and national conference, where we will unveil our own agenda created independently of the participation and wishes of either of the bourgeois political parties and or institutions. So between today and November 5th and 6th, which is when our rally, march on the White House, and national conference will occur, we will begin the process of forging, under the leadership of the coalition. Everybody want to play with this, join it, right? Assemblies throughout the United States where African people can come together. We will create our own independent national Black agenda that we will unveil in November. This is the direction. We don't give a damn who gets elected or what gets elected. The thing is that we want to hit the ground running with our own agenda, and that's the critical thing that has to happen. So it is our responsibility to determine the path of our struggle. The critical issues affecting us cannot be left to the wishes and interests of any other group. We can and must demand reparations, regardless of Sanders, Clinton, Obama, Trump, or any other representative of white power. Our national Black agenda for self-determination must include this invaluable and just demand. Our agenda must demand the release of all Africans being held in the concentration camps of the United States called prisons. and especially our beloved political prisoners who have sacrificed everything for the emancipation of our people. Our agenda will doubtlessly decry any taxation of African people by the United States government and any of its agencies. I unite with Ron Isley and Wesley Snipes and whatever Wesley's sister's name. We don't owe them a damn thing. In fact, it's our money and we want it now. I assume we will also demand the immediate withdrawal of all colonial occupation police military forces from our community and their replacement by black community control of the police. Black community control of the police. Proportionate representation within all the current existing government authorities, including electoral position, is something that some are demanding within our communities. An end to the brutish removal of Africans from our community is usually referred to as gentrification. And look at what they're doing right here in our Harlem. It is ridiculous. Community control of our schools and education, etc. These are just some of the likely demands that will be included in an independent national black agenda for self-determination. And it has to also say something about what they're doing with housing projects throughout this country. And that they're turning them into places for just African women and children. This worthless, horrible punishment that they call welfare that requires that there can be no African men in the houses and stuff like that as a condition. They require disunity of our community as a condition of getting pennies from this government. So, I mean, these are issues that I think that our agenda should reflect. And we will not neglect Africa and the host of other imperialist military occupation and must end, and reparations to Africa for the loss of life and resources that include the black bodies forcibly dispersed across the earth must become a part of our agenda. Down with AFRICOM. Down with the U.S. military bases throughout the continent of Africa. Out, out, out. They all have to go. We have to deal with this issue of immigration. Here, white people leave Europe hungry and starving. Come to a land and steal it from a people who are thriving. Take the land, push them into concentration camps that are now referred to as Indian Reservation. Come to our Africa, attack Africa, kidnap us, bring us here and disperse us around the world. Then steal half of Mexico, and they're the only legal people in the damn country. We have no respect for that at all. We have no respect for a situation where they talk about legal and illegal immigrants, where an African cannot even get to this country, can't get a visa out of Africa, can't get a visa in any other places. They steal and extort their money, have them standing in lines all day in the hot sun, take money that's worth 2 or 3 months' salary from them, and then deny them the right to come to this country. They're saying that the only Africans who can come to this country have to come in chains, be slaves. And we say, hell no, that doesn't work. Open up the borders. Open the damn borders. Let everybody in. So, we say, I have to go now. It is also likely that we will demand the immediate cessation of U.S. support for the white nationalist settler state of Israel and a transparent process of negotiation with the indigenous peoples of the U.S., victims of genocidal terror and land expropriation and annexation that had left the people in concentration camps euphemistically called Indian reservations with an unacceptably depressed life expectancy. Our agenda will most likely unite with the Mexican people who are spoken of so disparagingly by all bourgeois parties and candidates, every one of them speaks. I don't care. They don't have a good line on the Mexican. Well, we'll let them in. We have guest workers. Guest workers, hell, you, if anybody should be the damn guest, it's their land. And you're going to let them come in as guests. Somebody come in and rob you, steal your house, and then kick you out and then tell you you can come in as a guest. Hell no. We unite with the Mexican people. It's their land. We recognize that half of Mexico was taken by gunpoint from the Mexican people, and an artificial border created that separates the people from their own resources and from each other, and that facilitates the wealth of the white ruling class and whites in general. Our agenda will be able to unite with the popular declaration of the Mexican people, quote, "We didn't cross the border crossed us." At our November 5th and 6th rally, march on the White House and National Conference just 4 days after the national election for U.S. President, the coalition will unveil the People's National Black Agenda for Self-Determination. With this agenda, our own, we begin the process of charting our own course. We free ourselves from the political whims of white power and all of its agencies, and we reestablish our legitimacy as an oppressed people determined to be free on our own terms. With this approach, we can win. We will win. We are winning. Black self-determination now.